Welcome back to the class, students. Today we'll be starting a new chapter, Preventive Medicine in Obstetrics, Pediatrics and Geriatrics. What are the components of antenatal care? The first component is antenatal registration and maintenance of the card. You have antenatal history, antenatal examinations, antenatal investigations, antenatal advice and antenatal services. So these are the components of antenatal care. We'll be looking at them individually. What are the objectives of maternal and child health? These are very important. Sometimes they can be directly tested. The first objective of MCH is reduction of maternal, perinatal, infant and childhood mortality. That is the first and the foremost objective. The second objective is promotion of reproductive health in the population and promotion of physical and psychological development of the child as well as the adolescent. So these are our target groups then. These are the people we are concerned about. We are concerned about antenatal mothers. We are concerned about their delivery. We are concerned about their puerperal period. We are also concerned about the children, and not only children, we are also concerned about adolescents. So these things are covered under these programs. Antenatal registration. What is done? Antenatal registration is done after the confirmation of pregnancy. Antenatal card is prepared, which has the registration number, identification data, details of previous and past history. So these details are present on the antenatal registration card. It helps in enumeration of the mothers, and it also helps to calculate the MMR and IMR. Here I should tell you, recently Government of India in collaboration with WHO has made a new antenatal registration card, which has also the provision of growth chart included in the card itself. So that is a new card that has been recently introduced, which has the provision of growth chart into the same card. Antenatal registration card no doubt help us to calculate the MMR and IMR. I hope by now you know what MMR and IMR are. They are maternal mortality ratio and infant mortality rate. Lastly, they help us to evaluate how the services are working. They help us to evaluate the MCH and FP services, maternal and child health and family planning services. Antenatal visits. A frequent question will be asked in your VIVAs, will be asked in the MCQs. What are the ideal antenatal visits? Right now, a bit of gray area, because various sources mention various visit schedules. But still, in the reference books, we have this schedule and therefore it is put. But remember, before your examination, there are certain numbers, there are certain facts and figures. Like I told you, we will be discussing in the high yield notes section. I will be sharing with you, but these are certain things that needs to be revised just before the examination. Not a day or two or a month or two before the examination, but maybe a couple of months before, because these are liable to change. And one such thing is antenatal visits. So what is recommended is that the mother should have one antenatal visit per month for the first 7 months of pregnancy. So for the first 7 months, she goes once a month. In the 8th month, she goes twice a month. And afterwards, in the 9th month, she goes once every week until delivery. So please remember this. Once a month for 7 months, twice a month in the 8th month, every week in the 9th month. That is the schedule ideally to be followed. If this is not possible, and very commonly in Indian context, you will see that this is not followed. What is the minimum recommended visits? The minimum recommended visits, as I was telling you, differs, but what is still followed is that 3 visits are minimum. The first visit should be as soon as the mother comes to know that she is pregnant, or at least by the 20th week of pregnancy. So that should be the first visit. The second visit should be at 32 weeks, and the third visit should be 36 weeks. These visits are very intelligently designed and they have a specific purpose. Say for example, we'll take the 36th week. We want to assess the possibility of a normal labor. So that visit is important. 32 weeks, you have to have the assessment of the treatment that is given, the iron and folic acid supplementation, these preventive measures we have to assess. We also have to give the TT injection. You remember the schedule? So the TT injection is scheduled here. And the first visit, obviously, you will have to do all the antenatal investigations. Start with the iron and folic acid tablets as well as the first dose of the TT. So these visits are timed according to the rationale. So remember, first visit as early as possible or at 26 weeks, second visit at 32 weeks, and the third visit at 36 weeks. How many minimum are recommended? Minimum recommended are 3. What is the ideal schedule? Once a month for 7 months, twice a month in the 8th month, and every week in the 9th month. Coming to the antenatal history. When the case comes to you, what important history should be taken? First and foremost, you should have the date of LMP. LMP is the last menstrual period. You should calculate the date of EDD. EDD is the expected date of delivery. I hope you know the Naegele's formula, 9 months and 7 days. So the LMP plus 9 months and 7 days roughly gives you the EDD. Obstetric history. You should know the gravida status, the para status, abortions, the history of stillbirths, number of living children, number of dead children, and their causes. Everything is important. And the importance is self-explanatory. If a mother has got previous bad obstetric history, multiple abortions, what trimester the abortions were there, that is important to know so that we can prevent those complications in the current pregnancy. What are the antenatal investigations that you should do when the pregnant female comes to you? You should do urine for albumin, sugar, and microscopy. We are in the habit of saying routinely that do a routine urine examination. That routine urine examination means albumin, sugar, and the microscopy. We will do the blood test for hemoglobin, VDRL, ABO grouping, RH typing, tri-dot, and HBsAg. There are a few new entrants here. The new entrants are the tri-dot and HBsAg. I hope all of you know that tri-dot is done for HIV positive testing and HBsAg is done for hepatitis B status. So HBsAg gives hepatitis B status, tri-dot gives HIV. The rest are pretty standard. They have been followed for decades now. Hemoglobin for screening of anemia, VDRL for syphilis, ABO grouping and RH typing for looking at RH incompatibility status. You also do stool for ova and cyst to rule out helminthic infections. Why are we worried now? We are worried because you know helminths rob the females of the precious iron stores. They can land the female as an anemic patient, which is not good for the outcome of the fetus. And therefore you check for ova and cyst. If helminths are there, anti-helminthic treatment is called for. And other investigations as and when the case mandates. Antenatal advice. What are the pertinent antenatal advice that should be given to the pregnant female? Mothers constitute captive audience. They are advised on the following issues. First of all, what is captive audience? Captive audience is an audience which is likely to listen to you, which you have in your captivity, which are a taken. So these are the audience which are interested in what you are talking. The advice that you give to a pregnant female is not likely to fall on deaf ears. So therefore, this is a very good group for antenatal advice. So they should be advised on nutrition. These points that you see on the slides right now and that will be appearing are important things not only for your examinations but also for practice. And these are also very commonly tested. You should have no restriction in the diet. That should be made clear. You should have a balanced diet. There should be no food or fruit which is abort efficient. This is a very common misconception that Indian females have. Most probably everybody will come to you asking, doctor, should I avoid papaya because my mother-in-law or my mother says that papaya is an abort efficient. So you must emphasize that there is no fruit which is abortifacient. There is no food which you should not consume. There is nothing which should harm. You should have a balanced diet. You should not restrict your diet. You should have more of green leafy vegetables which aid in iron and improve the anemic status of the mother. Avoid spicy foods on personal hygiene grounds. What do you say? Advice for daily bath. Advice for cleanliness and light and loose clothes. Not to be very particular about nipples, because as I told you, sometimes females are very much concerned about inverted nipples or lactation. These fears should be relieved. On rest and sleep, they should rest for 2 hours after lunch and 8 hours during night. So that is the advisable schedule for rest for a pregnant female. Advice on exercise. Light work can be done. This is important. Light work can be done. Bed rest is not usually warranted. Walking in the morning and the evening is preferred. Excessive physical labor should be avoided. That can cause preterm labor. Excessive physical labor can cause preterm labor or preterm delivery. Advice on drugs. Should avoid self-medication. That is very important. Fortunately, many people know this, but still you cannot take this for granted. Many people would be ignorant that self-medication should be avoided in pregnancy. Doctors should not prescribe steroids, streptomycin, tetracycline and any other drugs which are likely to harm the outcome of the fetus. So drug prescription should not be very casually given. X-rays should be avoided. Nowadays, fortunately, the need for X-rays is almost invalidated. We have something called as the ultrasonography, and ultrasonography is a beautiful tool, not only for the monitoring of pregnancy but also a lot of other indications, and therefore the need of X-ray is completely gone now. On habits, alcohol and smoking are strictly prohibited. On sexual relations, they should be restricted during the last trimester because they can lead to again premature labor. To be prohibited if there is a history of miscarriage or premature delivery. So any female who has a bad obstetric history, sexual relations should be prohibited during the period of pregnancy. What should be told as far as the warning signs are concerned? Bleeding per vaginam is a definitive warning sign. You should inform the patient about this. Blurring of vision, convulsions, loss of fetal movements, severe headache or giddiness, and any other unusual symptoms. So this is the list. The patient should be made aware that if any of these happens, the patient should immediately report to the health facility. Blurring of vision is a sign of preeclampsia. Loss of fetal movements could be due to IUGR, could be due to fetal distress or straight away fetal death. Convulsions is again eclampsia. Severe headache and giddiness, PIH, and any other usual symptoms. So these are symptoms for the most common complications of pregnancy, and they are severe complications. So therefore the patient should be made aware of these. The antenatal services offered. You have nutritional services, immunization services, medical services, family welfare, and educational services. So this is the plethora of service that is offered to the expectant mothers. Coming to the first service that we offer, the nutritional service. Food supplementation is done in the ICDS. Okay, food supplementation is an important component of ICDS. When we'll see the national health programs, you will also see the various programs which supplement food to the pregnant females as well as the children. Nutrition education should be given. As I told, there should be no dietary restrictions, and the female should be advised on eating foods which are healthy, which are rich in iron. Namely, what are the practical suggestions? Jaggery, groundnut, green leafy vegetables and fruits. So these should be advocated for consumption. Immunization services. You have immunization against tetanus. That we have already seen with tetanus. Two doses of tetanus toxoid to be given to the primi gravida. If she is not a primary gravida, it is a second pregnancy, then only one booster dose of tetanus toxoid is required. Two doses are not required. Immunization against RH incompatibility is available nowadays, so that could also be given for RH incompatibility. What are the medicinal services that are offered? The medicinal services are supplementation of iron and folic acid tablets. This is very, very important. You have a free supply of iron and folic acid tablets from the government to the pregnant female under the National Anemia Control Program. So these tablets should be started as early as the first visit of the patient, so that the anemia levels build up till delivery and the mother is not anemic for delivery. The complications of anemia are manifold, but the most important complications of anemia are hemorrhage and susceptibility to infection. The baby can have low birth weight, he can have IUGR. So there are a lot of complications of anemia, but these are the important complications which can be very simply avoided by the nutritional advice and the iron and folic acid supplementation. Folic acid, as you all know by your knowledge of biochemistry, is required to avoid neural tube defects in the baby. So a mother who is deficient in folic acid makes a deficient folic acid supply to the baby, and then he becomes prone to neural tube defects. So that is the importance of the IFA tablets. IFA is iron and folic acid. You have the distribution of DDK, that is a dye delivery kit. You have some varieties of that kit. We will see what those varieties are and what is supplied under those varieties. And anti-helminthic drugs such as mebendazole for deworming. As we already discussed, these worms can rob precious iron and can cause malnutrition. If VDRL is positive, that is the test for syphilis is positive, treatment should be given accordingly. If SBS-AG is positive, mother should not be given vaccine, but newborn to be given both active and passive immunization. So the baby should receive vaccine against SBS as well as active immunization, that is the immunoglobulin. So vaccine and immunoglobulin both are warranted for the baby if the SBS-AG is positive. If mother is HIV positive, again, as I said, this is a recently introduced thing. You should know this can appear. What happens if the mother is positive on the tri-dot? You do a confirmatory test and she is still positive. What happens in that case? What happens if the mother is HIV positive? What happens is what is shown on your slide right now. You have the PPT-CT program, which is called as the prevention of parent to child transmission. Okay, so PPT-CT program, earlier it was mother to child transmission, and we thought that it is not right to blame the mother, because most of the time the mother gets the infection from the father. So therefore we are nullifying the blame game, and now it is prevention of parent to child transmission. Okay, so let us look at the chart in front of you. I have made this colorful because I want to focus your attention here. This is the most common category that the female will come to you. Although you have a category before that and a category after that, if you are working in a hospital, if it is an institutional delivery, it is most likely that you will see a female in this category, and therefore this is colored. So let us have a look at the most important category that you should know. The females usually in India in the rural background and many urban settings directly come for delivery to the hospital. So that is the first time you are seeing the lady. She has directly come for delivery to the hospital. There is no past history, there is no antenatal care, there is no supplementation of iron and folic acid, and you have just done a tri-dot and the tri-dot has come positive. In that circumstance, what are you supposed to do? So that most common setting is discussed here. What we do is intrapartum, that is during the labor, the lady is given a tablet of nevirapine 200 milligram stat. Stat means then and there. So she is given a tablet of nevirapine 200 milligram then and there, and postpartum to the newborn, nevirapine is given 2 mg per kg body weight, a single dose, within 72 hours. So within 7 days, the newborn should have nevirapine 2 mg per kg body weight. That is the schedule which is followed. And since I told you this is the most common scenario that you can have, probably this is the most important of the table that you should remember. You also have other recommendations. Say for example, what happens if the pregnant female is under regular care? She is a ANC clinic attendee. So you know her past history, you know the investigations. In that case, what you should do is that you should start with zidovudine 300 mg twice a day from the 34th week till the time of labor. So zidovudine 300 mg twice a day should be started from the 34th week. Intrapartum, you should increase the dose, and zidovudine should be given 3 hourly. Zidovudine should be given 3 hourly. Remember, this is a massive hike in the dose, 300 mg per 3 hours. Postpartum, the zidovudine should be given 4 mg per kg body weight for 6 weeks to the newborn. So, if the mother is under care, you have a zidovudine regimen, remember. If the mother is not under care, she has directly come in labor, you have a nevirapine regimen. Say, the mother comes to you after the delivery. So, there was no ART before in the ANC time. There was no ART intrapartum. What happens? In that case, nevirapine, as we had seen in this column, is given just to the baby to reduce the chances of infection. So, that is the schedule. I have spent enough time on this schedule. This is important. Remember, if the mother is under follow-up, zidovudine regimen. If the mother is not under follow-up, she comes to you at the time of delivery, nevirapine regimen. If she comes to you after delivery, we give nevirapine just to the baby. Coming on to the last row. The last row talks about infant feeding. What to do about the breastfeeding. As already discussed, mother will have to choose between exclusive breastfeeding and other safe alternatives. As we have already seen, an option has to be given, and if the mother can assure that she can have safe external feeds to the baby, do that exclusively. If you can say that the mother is not supposed to, or she will not be able to have safe external feeds, then breastfeeding is better. Okay, this is important. Under no circumstances, combined feeding should be recommended. What is combined feeding? The mother is breastfeeding and top foods are also given. This is the worst thing that can happen. Either go on completely top foods or completely stick to breastfeeding. Combined feeding has the most risk of infection.